Welkom allemaal, welcome everybody. On behalf of Writers Unlimited Festival, who organizes this monthly series, together with Central Library The Hague, and also on behalf of publisher Meulenhof, who invited Jhumpa Lahiri over to the Netherlands. I'm very happy that all of you have come, and I'm especially happy that Jhumpa Lahiri and Tanya Yatnanansing will be here tonight to have a conversation about the newest book of Jhumpa Lahiri, which is called The Lowland in English. And in Dutch, it's translated as Twee Broers. It's a beautiful, beautiful novel. It's been shortlisted for the Booker Prize, and it's been nominated for the National Book Award. And it's for whom who hasn't read it yet, I can really highly recommend it. It's beautiful. And, well, I'd really love to ask Jhumpa Lahiri and Tanya Yatnanansing to join us here and to have a seat, and please give them a warm welcome. Tanya Yatnanansing, ladies and gentlemen. Tanya is a member of parliament. She was a former journalist, and she used to interview and present to work as a presenter for television, and she's a lover of the books of Jhumpa Lahiri, and I wish you a very nice conversation, both of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, and a warm welcome to all of you, of course. And actually, you know, I haven't told Jhumpa this yet, but they called me from Winternachten, and they said, you know, do you want to interview Jhumpa Lahiri? And I was like, yeah, of course I want to interview Jhumpa Lahiri. And this morning I was just knocking my head. Why did I say I wanted to interview Jhumpa Lahiri? Because, you know, it's very difficult when you're a huge fan of somebody and you have to interview that person. So I'm really nervous. So you have to help me tonight. Actually, you know, maybe just to ease me a little, I can ask you at first to tell us about your newest book, The Lowland, because a lot of people, it just was released, like, I think some days ago. So I don't think, who has already read the book, Lowland? So still a couple of people, but not a lot. So maybe you just could take us on a journey. What is the book about?
Certainly. Well, first of all, good evening. Thank you all for coming. Please don't be nervous. I look forward to talking to you about the book. Really happy to be here. I'll tell you a little bit about how the book was born. I, at some point in my life, heard about an execution that took place very close to my paternal grandparents' home in Calcutta. Two brothers were killed one evening by the Indian paramilitary during the repression of a violent radical movement called the Naxalite movement, which was causing a great deal of upheaval in Calcutta and in other parts of India for a few years in the late 60s and early 70s. I heard about this and was very troubled by what I heard. I spent a lot of time myself in that particular neighborhood because it is where my paternal grandparents lived. And so when I would go to visit Calcutta throughout my life, I would stay there for weeks at a time. And so I had a very vivid sense of the place. And so a part of me was very shocked by what I heard because I had spent so much time there, but I never knew that this very, very violent, very brutal thing had happened there, just steps from the home where I would stay. So when I was just starting out as a writer, this was 16 years ago, I was just beginning to think about things to write about, what I wanted to write about, stockpiling some ideas. And so one of the ideas that came to me at that time was to write about these two brothers and what had happened to them that evening, and why this had happened. These were all of the things that I didn't really understand at the time. I just had a vague sense. So I started to write the book, but I only got as far as a few pages. I just wrote a very brief scene of someone being executed in front of his family, which was similar to what had happened in real life. The boy's parents and other family members were summoned and lined up to watch, to witness the execution. And this was something that was fairly common at the time in Calcutta. This was happening, these sorts of police raids were happening almost every night as the government was going through carefully through the city, through the neighborhoods, trying to find people, usually young students whom they suspected of being involved with this movement, trying to find them, and they would either imprison them or kill them on the spot. So what happened to these two brothers is one of, sort of background of ongoing violence during those years. Anyway, so I wrote a brief scene, and then I really didn't know what else to do after a few pages. So I set it aside, a bit frustrated, but also feeling that I couldn't force something that didn't seem to be coming naturally. I went on to publish my three other books, and then 10 years later, in 2008, after my last book was published, I finally went back to this idea and the brief scene that I had written, and at that point began to work with this story again. So that's a long way of explaining that this book has had a very slow and long genesis. It's something that I have known about. I mean, the idea comes from something I've known about for much of my life, and the desire to create a story out of this is something that has accompanied me for 16 years. And so I started really writing the book in 2008 after a 10-year hiatus, when I was maybe thinking about it on some very unconscious level, and then finished it just last year.
So it took you 5 years to write it, maybe?
Yeah.
But you said 16 years you've been evolving this idea of this novel.
Yes.
So we all have this idea of a writer sitting down and writing the book and maybe finish it in 6 months.
That would be nice.
Yeah, but that's definitely not the case. You've actually worked on this book for many, many years and written some other books in between. Am I correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So how does it feel to actually complete this book? Is it like you're fulfilled now?
I feel relief, I suppose, of having finished something that I was struggling to make for all of these years. And I mean, many ideas, you begin them and then they don't become something in the end, and that's a part of the process. Not every idea is seen to a conclusion, to fruition. But this was an idea that I felt, I felt strongly enough about, so that even 10 years later, I felt I still felt connected to it, and I think I felt a little bit more prepared as a writer, perhaps a little bit more mature as a writer, and also as a person, to confront some of the themes of the book because you know they're quite complex in a way. And so I'm glad that I waited in the end.
Do you think you needed all the other books to be written before you could finish this book?
I think so. I mean, I think the more you do something, there is a sense of, at least the sense of that all of the time that you've spent working with characters, with language, with putting stories together. And even though each book seems, each book is very new and each book feels like its own new mountain to climb. But I think if you've climbed a few mountains before, even though it's the ascent is always difficult, always daunting, but at least you know that you have made the ascent previously, and that gives you some encouragement, I suppose.
You have, in all your books, there are themes coming together. One of them, which I really like, is the one of, well, I don't like it because it's not a happy thing, but it's the feeling disconnected, being part of a society, but not really being part of it because you came from somewhere else. In this crowd, there are a lot of people from Suriname Hindu people, and so they traveled from India to Suriname, from Suriname to Holland. And so where is your home, actually? Where is home? And you really want to let Holland be your home, but then it's not. Suriname's not. India is not. And that's what actually drew me to your books, especially the namesake. I just cried a lot in that book because I felt coming home in the book. Like, okay, somebody is actually understanding how I feel. Then in this book, The Lowland, it became even heavier. The nobody was connected to each other. Everybody was really lonely. And still, this is really wonderful about this wonderful writer, because it's a heavy book, and then again, it's light. So how can you do that? What's the process?
Well, I think the one thing I could control... Well, I can control lots of things, I suppose, in the book, but I was able to make a decision about the tone of the book. And I think I agree with you that the book has some, I mean, there's a weightiness to the book because it begins with this, as its starting point, this brutal execution. That is the, you know, what sets into motion a series of other events, and it the book sort of increases in intensity rather than, in other words, the execution isn't the only brutal thing that happens in the book. There's it sets off a series of events that are. Also difficult to bear in a way. So I felt that I wanted the writing of the book to be very as simple as possible and very just very clear and very very simple, so that the prose wasn't also very heavy. I wanted to give the book some air, some circulation. So that is how I try to balance it, so sort of the tonal aspect of the book. I mean, I think if you think about it in terms of a painting, it's like, if you choose sort of a watercolor technique versus working with, a heavier medium, and it renders the subject differently. So I think for a writer, we can control these things through the tone of the writing and the way we put the sentences together.
You have in this book, there are a lot of characters, but I think, I don't know, you're the writer, so you correct me, but I think there are three main characters, which are the two brothers and the Gauri, the wife of Udayan. And Udayan was killed, murdered, executed, And then the other brother who went to America to study came back and married Gauri. And Gauri was pregnant of a girl named Bela later. And Bela never knew that Subhas wasn't her father, that Udayan, who was killed, was her father. So this is, the story is really complex. I had to read the book in 2 days between preparing for debates in parliament on prostitution and education and whatever. And I just couldn't sleep. I had to write, I had to read the book. And it's because of you that I blew my debate today.
Oh, no.
No, it's not true. It's not true. Actually, it's not true. But it was so complex, and in the complexness, it was like haunting me. Read me, read me. So I was just wondering, how do you go about? Do you write a sentence and then you say, okay, now my readers will really enjoy themselves, or you know, how does this evolve?
Well, to be honest, I don't really think about my readers when mm-hmm. I'm writing the book.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very, you know, I write it in a very private psychological space
mm-hmm.
For the vast majority of the writing process. I would say 98% of the process is taking place in a dimension where I am very alone with the book and just putting it together in my workshop.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think about who's going to read it and what they're going to think of it
mm-hmm.
until the very end. And then I allow some time at the very end to think about how the book will be read. And at that point, you know, I begin working with an editor and some other mm-hmm. readers to ask them some questions, mm-hmm. you know, in terms of, okay, how do you think, you know, I use them as a test audience, as yeah. if you will, and get some comments from them to see, okay, they say, oh, this part seems it seems slow, we don't need this information, this is more interesting, that, so then I have a sense of some of these reactions, and I can modify some things. But I most of the writing is really a sort of dialogue with myself. So I don't think about those things.
Yeah. And then you know, you don't write for the readers, which I think is very good. But then again, at some point, it's like giving your baby to the world,
yes.
and everybody can comment. Does it have any effect on you if people are negative of what you've written?
Well, I don't read what people write about my work.
Mm-hmm.
I never read anything.
Mm-hmm.
I don't go on the internet, and I don't read the newspapers or the magazines. For a year after my books are published, I don't really go. I don't read any newspapers or magazines.
Yeah. And this is because you just hide away, I don't want it, or you don't care?
It's both.
Mm-hmm.
I think it helps me to keep my equilibrium as a writer, to be aloof from it as much as possible, because I want, at this point, I want to just go back to work,
yeah.
you know. Now, that doesn't mean that I don't hear anything, because I talk to people along the way. I'm talking to you now.
Yeah.
I spent today giving 6 interviews with people who have read the book and
wow.
have things
yeah.
to say about it
yeah.
and have questions. I do end up having more than enough conversations with people to have a sense of how they react to the
mm-hmm.
book.
Mm-hmm.
But what I don't read, what I try to avoid, is all of the other noise out there in the world. And so unless someone comes up to me and says, I hated your book,
yeah.
I tend not to absorb anything negative or positive
yeah.
About the book. And I feel that, you know, it's all there. It's all locked inside the computer screen at this point. So if I ever feel the need to read the reactions, I can.
Yeah,
but I haven't.
Actually, yesterday I did some research, of course, on you and on what people are saying. I'm not going to tell you because that's not the point at this moment. But what I read was almost 90% of it was really positive, or even more, like she's brilliant and everything. But you know, you have these big themes in your book, and do you want people to also debate on those themes, or just, you know, me to read it and just enjoy myself and that's it? Or would you really be honored if people would, you know, just take your book and have a debate on it, on migration or being disconnected or anything? Making it more politic.
I have no expectation of what happens to my books after they're published. I mean, I want to write the best book that I can in any given frame of time that I think is justifiable for the book, for the idea. And then I finish the book and I give the book, you know, to the publisher, and they take it and they turn it into a book. And then I cut my connection to the book. And what happens to the book, whether 3 people read it, whether 300,000 people read it, what they say about it, what they make of it, whether they simply read it and enjoy it and put it away and never think about it again, or if they read it and throw it across the room because they can't stand it, or if they read it and talk to their friend about it at lunch. I mean, whatever they do with it, is there?
It's okay with
it's,
you.
It's there. Yeah. It's no longer my. It's no longer something I control, and I don't feel. You know, I feel quite disconnected, in fact, and I need to feel disconnected, in order to make new work.
Yeah.
So I don't have any specific intention or expectation of how the books are received.
And actually, in almost all of your books, there are also people in there, like Gauri and other, who are just like as disconnected. You know, they do their thing, and the result, it really doesn't matter, it seems. So that is that a little bit of you in there, or it has nothing to do with it?
Well, I do write a lot about people who are both dislocated and disconnected, as you say. I agree with you, and I think both of those things are very much, you know, aspects of my own reality as a person. I mean, I'm the product of displaced people, and as a result of my family's displacement, there was a sense of a profound sort of lack of connection with, you know, first of all, with the country we were living in. You know, when I was a young girl, I really felt that I was only connected to my mother and father, because there was nobody we were connected to in a familial sense in the entire country of America.
Because you grew up in London, right? And then you went to America, and now you live in Italy. So that's quite nice. But you said in the your childhood, you felt connected to your parents, and that was it.
That was sort of it. You know, I mean, I felt, I was aware that my parents were not fundamentally connected to America on a whole series of levels. They weren't connected to the culture. They weren't really connected to the people. My mother didn't work, so she had an even more acute sense of a lack of connection. My father worked. He had colleagues. He had a job. He had a sort of professional connection. My mother didn't have that even for many years. And so as a result, I was aware of how disconnected they felt. They did form connections. It's not that they had no friends. They had friends, but they were friends. They tended to be other disconnected friends. Mm-hmm. So there was a sort of
community of disconnected
yeah. people who yeah. just clung to each other.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that was my experience yeah. of growing up.
Did you, maybe this is too personal, you don't answer it if you think so, but did you blame your parents for that? For, you know, just not getting connected?
Well, no, I didn't. I wouldn't say that I blamed them. I mean, I knew that it was hard for them, and I would see how they were, how they behaved, how they carried themselves mm-hmm. in America. I would see that every day. There was a sort of sense of always being a little bit nervous about everything. You know, nervous about how they spoke. Were they being understood? Were they doing the right thing? Were they decorating the Christmas tree the right way? I mean, everything was like this exotic yeah. project all the time for them. They didn't know yeah. until many years passed, and slowly they began to learn the language of a new country. And I think this is true for any migrant. Yeah. I mean, you have to learn a new language. Not only, I mean, my parents knew English, but English was the least of their problems. It was everything else
yeah.
that was indecipherable for so long. So even their attempts to be more integrated were not easy.
Yeah.
You know, it was a constant learning curve. And then I would see how they behaved and carried themselves in contrast when we would go back to India. When they would go back to India,
did they immediately feel at home?
They were different yeah. people. They mm-hmm. would turn into different people. Mm-hmm. And I saw this transformation. And it really would strike me every time, you know, that in America they were a certain way. And then they would get off the plane in Calcutta and they were just, you could see the physically just in their face, the way they would speak, the fact that they could just speak their own language and not give a damn about having an accent.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it was just such a relief to them. And so these were things I was observing from, I mean, all my life. I've observed distinction between, I mean, how a migrant feels depending on where, you know, whether they're in the new place or going back to the old place. But I never blamed them. It was a choice they made. It was a complicated choice, and it led to a complicated life in yeah. many ways, but I think that they in the end gave me an experience of life which is quite valuable.
Yeah. You know? Because for one thing, it helped you write these beautiful books, feeling disconnected. I think a lot of what I already said, a lot of people in this room also have the same experience, not belonging in Holland, not belonging in Suriname, not belonging in India. So where do you belong? And still making most of it. And you can turn it around. Actually, you can say that, what a richness. I don't belong anywhere, so I can be anywhere. So you can turn it around. Mm-hmm. Is there a point that you thought, well, you know, I can be like a victim of being disconnected, or I can be like this winner of being disconnected and write prize-winning novels?
Well, I agree with you, and I think yes. I mean, when I was younger, I was much more. I felt the emptiness. I mm-hmm. felt the lack of a homeland. I felt the lack of belonging. I felt the lack of an identity. I felt the lack of a sort of solid ground, and I think I felt it even more than my mother and father, in a way, because even though they were displaced in the United States, they could get on a plane and go to India and feel at home,
yeah, yeah.
And they could go home. They had a home to go back to. even if they didn't live there anymore, it still it remains their home. Even now, 50 years later, they call it home. They still call it home. But I was never, I didn't feel that way when I went anywhere. I'm like the people you describe in, you know, here. And so, yes, when I was younger, I was preoccupied by this, and I wanted very badly to be a person with a more concrete sense of belonging somewhere. And then I think what liberated me and allowed me to see it as a richness, as you say, and I think it can be a richness, but you just have to look at it the right way, because if you look at it the wrong way, then it goes back to a lack. But if you change the way you look at it, it is an enormous richness. And I think one of the things, two things really, were sort of the fundamental events in my life that helped me to look at it differently. And one was becoming a writer, because I think when I began to write stories, I felt connected to my work.
Yeah. And my work. So there was the connection.
My work became the most important thing to which I belonged.
Yeah.
And then the rest of it didn't really matter anymore. I think writers, you know, they can live without a kind of fixed national identity in the end, because in the end, sort of human nature is your subject, right, broadly speaking. And so it doesn't really matter. And then the other thing, more personally, was becoming a mother. Mm-hmm. Because once I became a mother and had my own children, I felt that, you know, I belong to them. And they belong to me. And there was a sort of very powerful transformation. And again, that sense of where do I come from receded. Now I feel that my home is where I am, with my children and my husband, my desk, and it's possible for me to feel at home in Rome, or I would like to think maybe some other places too, and that gives me a great freedom.
Maybe it's because you came home to yourself that anywhere can be your home. Maybe that could be it, I don't know. But going back to the book, The Lowland, because there as I understood the book, none of the characters had a home at the end. You know, the Gauri didn't have a home. Maybe Subhas couldn't go back to India. He felt disconnected also there. Udayanwal was actually executed, so he was not here anymore. And I was thinking, because there were so many things going on, and Gauri, one of the main characters, the wife of Udayan, and she married then Subhas. Gauri had so many things going on in her life. And at one point, I was reading the book, and I was just looking, turning pages, and thinking, okay, now she's going to commit suicide. I just, you know, I just sensed it. And at one point, I read the book, and I said, okay, you didn't let her, you didn't make her commit suicide. And I was like, I think you did it on purpose. Why?
Why doesn't she commit suicide?
Yeah. You know, because, you will read the book and you will see there's so many things going on in her life. And actually the whole book, that part of the book, it just went to that point, and then she didn't. And there was a sort of a little bit of hope even. And I loved it, but I was like, Jhumpa, you disappointed me.
Yeah, I mean, I thought about her. I mean, I don't want to give too much of the story away, but I mean, since you've brought it up, I mean, I thought very seriously about this being a potential, conclusion for her. And then I thought about everything else that had happened in the book, and I felt that enough had happened in the book, and I thought about what really made me refrain from making that choice as a writer is that I thought about her daughter. I thought about the character of her daughter and what the daughter had already had to suffer throughout the book, which I don't want to really give away, but the daughter has borne a lot. And I felt that I didn't want to leave, I didn't want to end the book with the daughter carrying such a heavy weight for the rest of her life. I didn't want that. So I did, you know, I just felt that it was, that the book had enough darkness already, enough gravity in that sense. And
And for maybe in the audience now, people are thinking, okay, I'm not going to read the book because it's so heavy. It's not at all. It has a lot of heavy stuff going on. But what I really enjoy in all your books, but especially in this book, I think this is your best work yet. Because in this book, even though all the events are heavy on itself, the whole book together is... Actually, it's a book of... hope, especially at the end. And I can't give away everything, but it still has, you know, like human beings are struggling for life, for being together and trying, and it seems a little bit that it will happen in a sort of a way.
Well, I think in among other things, it's a book about survival.
Mm-hmm.
It's a book about endurance. It's a book about about loneliness and about feeling disconnected, but it's also a book about parenthood.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a book in which there are one particularly, I think, lovely bond between an unexpected but very deep bond between a parent and child.
Yeah.
So there are characters in the book who are deeply connected to each other. The brothers themselves are deeply connected to one another, and that the book begins with that sense of connection,
mm-hmm.
of being united with another person in your life, in your family, and the, you know, the perhaps inevitable evolution of certain bonds that we have as children with our siblings and our families, and what can happen over time.
You know, what I really liked about the book is that all the characters you've written it like that, they have two sides. They have a soft side and they have a really, you know, hard side in them. And so you, at the end of the story, you like all of them. So it's not like you're like, okay, I prefer Gauri and then I don't like Subhas or Andy, because you give a glimpse of their goodness and you give a glimpse of also the other side of, it's almost like human beings, you know, because we're not all the time we're that nice. We also have the other part of us. And is this deliberately that you said, I want them to be balanced in a way?
Well, I want them to be human,
mm-hmm.
as you say,
mm-hmm.
and human beings are complex
mm-hmm.
creatures with mm-hmm. With good, ideally, and with bad, inevitably. So I think for characters to be real, they have to have both.
Yeah.
Both of these dimensions.
Maybe I can ask you now to read a little piece of the book in which actually the complexity, a little bit of cruelness, and... it's my favorite part of the book.
Okay.
One of the many favorite parts of books.
So I've never read this section before, but I'm happy to.
Yeah.
This is about a middle of the way through the book, actually. So it's a scene in which Bella is the young girl. She's the daughter of Gauri, and she is, I think, 6 years old, and she's beginning to go to school, and her mother Gauri is at this moment beginning to become more and more devoted to her intellectual life. She's a graduate student in philosophy, and she's become quite committed to furthering her education and that's sort of the, I think, a little bit of background that will maybe help you to understand this section. One morning after a night of downpours, a light rain still falling, she handed Bella her lunchbox and sent her off. She was still in her nightgown, her robe. The day was her own until 3, when Bella's school ended, when the bus would drop her off and she would return across the sloping lawn. But today, a minute later, there was a knock on the door. Bella was back. Did you forget something? Do you want your rain hat? No. What is it then? Come see. I'm in the middle of something. Bella tugged at her hand. Ma, you have to come see. Gori took off her robe and slippers, putting on a raincoat and a pair of boots. She stepped outside, opening an umbrella. Outside, the air was humid, saturated with a deep, fishy stench. Bella pointed to the pathway. It was covered by a carnage of earthworms. They'd emerged from the wet soil to die. Not 2 or 3, but hundreds. Some were tightly curled, others flattened. Their rosy bodies, their 5 hearts, sliced apart. Bella shut her eyes tightly. She recoiled at the image, complained of the smell. She said she didn't want to step on them, and she was afraid to walk across the lawn from which they'd come. Why are there so many? It happens sometimes they come out to breathe when the ground is too wet. Will you carry me? You're too big. Can I stay home then? Gori looked up to where the other children stood under hoods and umbrellas. They seem to have managed, she said. Please, Bella's voice was small. Tears formed, then slid down her face. Another mother might have indulged her. Another mother might have brought her back, let her stay home, skip a day of school. Another mother, spending the time with her, might not have considered it a waste. Gori remembered how happy Subhash had been those days last winter when it had snowed so heavily and most everything was shut down. For a whole week he'd stayed home with Bella, making a holiday of it, playing games, reading stories, taking her out to play on campus in the snow. Then she remembered another thing, how, at the height of the crackdown, the bodies of party members were left in streams in fields close to Taliganj. They were left by the police to shock people, to revolt them, to make clear that the party would not survive. The school bus was approaching. Come. But Bella shook her head. No. If you don't get on the bus, we're going to walk to school over more worms than this. When Bella still refused to move, Gori grasped her tightly by the hand, causing her to trip, dragging her across. Bella was sobbing, audibly, miserably now. The other mothers and children gathered at the bus stop had turned their heads. The bus came to a stop. The door was opening, the rest of the children getting on. The driver was waiting for them. Don't make a scene, Bella. Don't be a coward. I watched your father killed before my eyes, she might have said. I don't like you, Bella cried out, shaking herself free. I'll never like you for the rest of my life. She ran ahead, abandoning her mother on the heels of summoning her, not wanting Gori to accompany her the rest of the way.
Yeah, so we're all a little bit silenced now because of the heaviness of this part of the book, because it's about, for me then, as I understood it, it's about a child asking her mother, can I stay home? Because there are those worms out there. And for me, that was, you know, all the things happening to Gauri, to Bella, and coming together there in all those worms, and, you know, it's not nice outside. And I would, you know, as a mother, I think you would say to your child, okay, come in, you know, let's have a cup of tea, talk a little bit, don't worry, tomorrow is another day. But Gauri says, no, you have to go to school. And it's not because Gauri wants Bela to go to school. Well, that's also part of it. But it's actually because Gauri wants to do her own thing. So she's really, you know, she has chosen the whole time for herself, not for her daughter. And it's what, when I read this part, it struck me that she didn't really care for her daughter. All she cared for was for her philosophy. And at that moment, I hated Gauri. And later on, when you read a lot about Gauri and what she has been through, you just turn around and say, okay, no, I can understand Gauri also. So I think, is this a thread through your work that you build those characters and you let them do really terrible things? And then at some point in the book, you give a look into their being, and they become like what we already said, human beings. Is this on purpose?
Well, I'm just trying to create complex and credible characters, and I want to present them as I believe they would behave. Mm-hmm. And I try to be true to them in terms of their behaviors. And I think sometimes we do things that we're not terribly proud of, that are petty, that are mean, yeah, that are cruel. And sometimes we do things like that. Often we do things like that to the people we love or should love, in Gauri's case. So I think, again, this is just an example of how to present a full character.
Yeah, you know? And it's also about, you know, in the whole of the book we have, there are lots of things going on about expectations. Have parents expect that those two boys to marry girls who are, you know, chosen by them? And then the boys actually don't do that. And there is also a parting of, you know, parents on the other side, one side, and the brothers on the other side. And I think this is one of the things which happens also here in Holland, with especially the Surinamese Hindustani girls, who are, you know, forced is maybe a too big a word, but still they are encouraged to marry people their parents approve of. And so there are these generation conflicts even now going on. And you already told me that, you know, your book is not about bringing up that debate or helping the debate, but still it helps. Can you imagine that your book is helping a lot of girls going through the process, even though you don't really write because of that effect?
Well, I think maybe a book, maybe not this book so much as the namesake, is a book that looks more closely at the process of, you know, the main kind of, the story itself is a story of a family migrating to America and what happens over the course of two generations and how the act of migration alters on a sort of almost at the chemical level, the family, the series of you know, the traditions, the expectations of that they leave behind, and the need to work from the ground up again to create you know, a new way and new sets of traditions, and the tension so often that exists between the children of migrants who are torn between two sets of loyalty, yeah, you know, to the parents who raised them and to the country at large that has also formed them in some way and has, I think, exists as a kind of third parent, you know. So perhaps that novel would be something that could be an interesting, yeah, book to read to have that sort of discussion.
Yeah, and actually in the Lowlands it's more, well, actually I read it, of course, of within my perspective of being a politician at this point in my life. And I really felt connected to Udayan, because he thought that, you know, being this politician or being involved in a political party was his highest thing to do in life. And he, as I see it, he even chose that above his family. So here the political person and the personal, it becomes, you know, it becomes one. And I was just thinking, because you're a writer, you're not a politician, and still you could get into the head of Udayan. So is this a writer's privilege, or is it you read a lot about how, you know, politicians think? Because it was so genuine and so real.
Well, thank you. I'm glad that you feel that way. I mean, I think it's a writer's job. That is what inspires a writer to imagine one's way into different people, different kinds of reality outside of one's own. I mean, none of the characters in this book is me. Mm-hmm. I don't know those experiences. So I have to work to try to imagine what it might be like to dedicate myself to a you know, Maoist political movement and believe that that is the solution for my country's problems. I have to imagine what it's like to be a mother who is who would rather push her child across the lawn when she's afraid, because I'd rather stay home and read my book.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know personally, you know, these experiences, but I try to imagine them, you know, but I think that's what all writers are are doing in the end. They're looking outside of their own limitations. And trying to connect to other you know, human beings, even if they're invented.
Yeah, that is, well, and let's connect to the audience now, because when you give me the room, I can talk to you for maybe 5 hours more. But that would be really impolite to the audience, because there are already, of course, questions in the audience. And maybe if people don't feel comfortable doing it in English, they can just do it in Dutch, and then we translate it. That's not a problem, because, you know, I read, before I go to the audience, I just want to tell you this. I really laughed. I read that Jhumpa is now living in Rome, and she's writing in Italian. And so she doesn't have a really big vocabulary on Italian, so her sentences are more shorter, and everything is, you know, just because you don't have that much of a language, that you go totally different. So don't feel ashamed, because she cannot speak Dutch, and not really...
Not at all.
Not at all. So you are that privileged there as an audience, and so just do it in Dutch if you like. So the floor is open to questions of the audience. You know, at first everybody is shy, and then after, when we are going to close up, everybody wants to ask a question.
I'd just like to ask, not about the book, but I'd like to ask what you read in your free time. What kind of books or non-fiction or fiction you read?
I read mainly fiction, and also some nonfiction having to do with often writers of fiction, like the letters of writers or biographies or essays that fiction writers or poets have written. For about almost 2 years, I've been reading predominantly in Italian. I mainly read 20th century Italian writers, not entirely, but mostly, novels, poetry, prose, letters. I'm right now reading the letters of Pavese. Reading has been, my passion from my childhood, and is the source of all of my writing.
Did you really knew I want to be a writer?
No, I didn't know that. I mean, I wrote as a young girl, but I never thought that would, you know, I never thought I would be a writer. Mm. No.
Next question. Because, you know, I have 100 questions. If you don't go, I will ask questions. But please, audience, do ask questions. And there's a lady in the back, I guess. Yeah. Maybe you could say your name.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Meenakshi. First of all, you said that your works are, you know, kind of, you stated it's kind of universally about human nature, but at the same time, they are very specifically rooted in a certain time and place. I mean, Bengali immigrants in northeastern United States of, you know, upper middle class background. How do you reconcile those two statements? And would you ever consider kind of moving beyond that very specific setting? Hmm.
Well, I think all universals have specific origin. I believe in the power of art, and I think art has a universal power. But if you look at works of art, if they're nothing if not specific. A painting by a Dutch master is a very specific thing. Why does it have power outside of Holland? You know, why does a landscape of this country move someone who's never been to this country? Why is that? It's because it has universal power, but it's about a specific thing. It's not a universal landscape that tries to encompass all landscapes. It's a very particular landscape, and it's the artist's attention to that particular landscape and the beauty he or she sees in that, and the power he or she sees in that allows people to connect across time, across space, across geography. And so to me, it's a given that my work is about specific things, specific experiences, specific people. All books, all novels are about specific characters living in a specific time and place. War and Peace is a specific novel about specific characters in a specific time and place. Why does it move people outside of Russia? You know, I mean, this is a basic truth. So I don't think there's anything to reconcile about those two statements.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, the audience likes your answer. You can applause, of course.
Hi, just following on from that question, actually, you seem to mine a very specific sort of reality, that of sort of the migrant experience. Would you ever consider mining your own, or is it too prosaic? Mm-hmm.
My own experience? I mean, I've written a few personal essays over the years. So I've visited a few isolated aspects of my personal time on this earth. So, I mean, maybe. I haven't really thought about it that much. I mean, I'm right now thinking a lot about my personal relationship to language, so that may end up being, in a way, a personal book, but with a more abstract subject matter. So, but generally, broadly speaking, I'm interested in the lives of other people more than my own in terms of subject matter, yeah. You know.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yes, I was wondering, because you were talking about being disconnected when you were a child, and now you have children yourself. do they feel disconnected? And if so, what do you do differently than your parents to make them feel less disconnected?
Beautiful question.
Well, my children are New Yorkers. They were born in New York City, and so unlike the millions of New Yorkers like me, you know, who live there and pay the taxes and everything, but we really come from other places. And New York is a beautiful city in that way, that anyone can become a New Yorker. But there are only certain people who can call themselves real New Yorkers, and they are the ones born in New York. So I have two of them. And they feel that that is their center. And now we live in Rome. And, you know, so they're aware that we are living in a foreign country and that they are outside of their normal, known, I should say, set of experiences. I think that's very healthy for them. I think this is a very good thing for them to experience at a young age. My husband and I are both people who have been exposed to different parts of the world all throughout our lives. My husband grew up all over the world, and I was raised in one place but always exposed to another part of the world. So we felt that it was important for our kids to have that experience as young people, to know what it's like to both to not belong to a place and to experience the discomforts of that and also the rewards of that. But I think it's different for my children also, because neither my husband nor I feel connected to any specific place. And we have a home in New York, but we don't. I mean, my husband was born outside of America, as was I, and I have always had a very complicated relationship with America, never really was able to identify fully as an American. And my husband also has a kind of fluid identity. So our children, I think, you know, we have a much more kind of movable notion of our home, and we don't connect our home to the sense of a homeland. And so they, I think they understand this about us, perhaps, on some intuitive level. But they also do have a very strong connection to New York and to America, broadly speaking. And I'm glad they have that. Mm-hmm. I'm glad my children have that. I think that's a nice thing to have, generally. I didn't have it, so I'm glad they have it. But I'm also glad to be able to take them out and to keep pushing their horizon wider, you know.
So don't bring them up in a sort of comfort zone? Is that it?
I think if children are loved, mm-hmm. if they're healthy and thriving, they feel they feel rooted, and, and they're very flexible creatures. They're more flexible than adults, which is a good thing. So they seem good. They're coming to Holland tomorrow.
Okay.
They will be exposed to yet another part of the world, and you know, this is a wonderful, I think this is, as a parent, I feel like it's the greatest gift you can give your child, is to expose them to as much of the world as possible.
Yeah. Next question. Oh, there are a lot.
My name is Ricardo, and I have a question about you, about the use of music or sound. This is my mother, Indra. And I feel like I have a connection with her because of music, traditional Indian and Surinamese music. Mm-hmm. And that's a place where we can connect. Do you use music or sound as a way to write stories or to connect with your parents?
I love music. I played instruments when I was younger, so I studied music. My mother is actually a very devoted fan of classical Indian music and all music. She loves a lot of music as well. She and I share a bond over classical Indian music. She introduced it to me and something she taught me to appreciate. I also feel connected to all other various other traditions of music. I don't really think about music directly as being connected to my work. I mean, there are phases when I write and I'm able to listen to music, and then there are other phases when I can't have any music going on. But generally, when I write, if I write and there's music, it's normally either Western classical music or jazz. I can't really concentrate if there's words. Becomes complicated.
Okay, next question.
Hello. You were talking about this complexity of the characters in your books, and this is true. This is what is very important for us as readers, because if the characters are complex, we can learn actually from them, and it enriches us, and we can understand life better actually in general. And how is it for you as a writer? Do you learn from your... You said that you have to go out behind your limits to look for what the character would do or would say or how he or she would react. Where do you get it from? I mean, do you learn from other books, or is it that you just think about it and you try to get it yourself?
I think probably the latter. I mean, I think I'm just thinking about it. I'm sort of meditating on it. And though I am going beyond myself to understand my characters, in the end, of course, they are coming from me. And I am the creator of the characters. So it's a very mysterious process. I can't really explain how characters are built, you know. But I think part of it is just living in the world and observing human nature on a variety of levels. I mean, there are the people you are. There's yourself, right? So you know yourself, one hopes. You know yourself. And then there are the people you have relationships with, you know, in varying degrees, the people you are very close to, the people you are a little bit close to, the people you are a little bit less close to. They're the people you meet once in your life on an airplane. Maybe you talk to them and you learn something from them. You know, something they say gives you a sense, a new window on what we are about as human beings. And I think what writers do is we have this secret bag and we keep putting all of this stuff into the bag unconsciously. Often we don't realize we're doing it, but we are. I know I am always looking in the world for these little clues, you know, to understand better who we are, why we are as we are. So then when it comes time to write, you know, I can think about, I mean, the way I think the imagination works is partly, you know, it's, you have to go out, as I said, you have to go outside of yourself, but you also have sort of this little private arsenal of things, impressions, conversations, relationships, whatever that you have stockpiled over the years, and that comes in very handy when you're building characters.
Yeah. There's a question over there. we don't have much time left, so if you have a question, please put your hand up.
You're just talking about building characters. When I was reading The Lowland, the gory character kind of reminded me of another character in one of your short stories. And my question is, because you said now, and I have a better understanding maybe about your process of writing, developing this character, because you started off with Lowland first, and you set it aside, and you turned to writing short stories. And in what way did writing the short stories then help you in order to finish your book?
Can I ask you what character she reminded you of?
I'm not, well, the way that she's cold-hearted, lonely, because in Unaccustomed Earth, I think, there were a number of characters who kind of had the same problems.
I don't know. I mean, I didn't think about any other characters I've written when I came to construct her character. I think that she is a sort of, in terms of the characters I've created, she's a sort of one of a kind, rather extreme character, if you will. But certainly writing short stories, you know, what ends up when you write short stories is that you end up having created lots of characters. So even though I've written 4 books, you know, within 2 of those books, there are 8 or 9 short stories with a group of characters in each of those stories. So it ends up that I feel like I've created many, many characters, even if I haven't created as many novels for the characters. But in short stories, you have to examine a character very, even more well. It's a different kind of examination process, but it's almost like you look at them with a magnifying glass. Mm-hmm. You know, you exaggerate certain aspects of them.
Yeah. So we still have time for one question, so let the
it's not a question I have, but more a compliment I want to give you, because I admire your book, The Namesake, because you have chosen a male main character, Gogol, and I love him. That I wanted to say. You have did it brilliant.
Thank you. Yes.
So there's the love for Gogol.
Maybe one last question over here.
Yeah.
Thanks. Hello, Ms. Hari. Thanks. I'm Mandy Danielski. I'm Brooklyn-born, so one of the few true New Yorkers. I find myself in Holland for the love of a man. He's a very entrepreneurial type, and I'm very academic type. I was wondering if you could talk about how your experiences at university and with your degree has informed your writing, and whether you feel that those years and those efforts added value, and if you would have come this far without that education. Thank you.
Well, it's hard for me to imagine an alternate reality. So, you know, my life is what it is. When I grew up in an academic world, an academic environment, my father works still at a university. So that was my, you know, personal landscape. And then I grew up and I studied and went to university, and I assumed I would be an academic. So I pursued that path, only to decide at a certain point that it was not what I wanted to do. Perhaps as a result of the many years I spent in an academic life, you know, I have a lot of characters who teach, professors and so on, but I think even without having gone to, you know, university for all of those years myself, because I grew up in that world, I mean, I grew up on a college campus, basically. So that was always part of my makeup as a person. So I can't really say, you know. I mean, one likes to not regret anything. So I think the happy answer is to say that everything was meant to be somehow. But perhaps if I hadn't, you know, I think maybe if I had been a different kind of person and much braver about my writing and less terrified about writing, maybe I would have gotten an earlier start as a writer, and maybe I would have written more books by now than I have. But, you know, it is what it is. You begin somewhere and you just do what you can with the time that you have.
Yeah. So you did. There is one lady in the back who was really pointing at me a long time. So I really want her to have the question.
Thank you very much. My name is Tina, and one day when I grow up, I really want to be a writer. I'm standing in front of you, and I'm in awe about your honesty, your sense of telling the truth, even to all of us. My only question would be, when you start writing your book, and you are well into it, can you please, for me, just describe one working day, your habits while you're writing the book, and maybe your worst habits while you're writing the book?
Yeah. Well, it's really very boring to describe. you know, you just... I write when... I tend to write when my children go to school and the house is quiet, and I don't know, I go up with a cup of coffee and I sit there and, you know, I write. And that's really all there is to explain, because it's cerebral, you know, it's not, it's an immaterial thing that's happening. I mean, there might be a keyboard or a pen and paper. So there's either a keyboard if I'm typing something, or there's pen and paper if I'm writing by hand. That's the only physicality. It's quiet, or sometimes maybe there's music. It's usually quiet.
What goes on?
Where? In my head?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, as I said, I think the closest, I mean, I'm not really in control of my life in that sense. Being a mother, having two children, they are, you know, they are my focus, and so I work around their needs and their schedule, and so that's really all I can say. I mean, you know, I don't write on the weekends. I don't write at night. I write during the day when they're at school.
Yeah. So this is a very, again, a very honest question. Don't make it into something heroic, like, you know, putting on some special clothes and having some special music. And, you know, because that actually, maybe that's just, we have this word in Dutch, aanstellerij.
And what it does, and, what does
and
that
I,
mean?
I don't, the audience should help me. What is aanstellerij in het Engels weer? Showing off. Thank you very much. Like showing off. I do that. Because when I go to a debate, when I have a political debate, I really, really hard music, and then it's songs from Lagan. You know, and that is, the, you know, because that's a story of a man calling all of his people on the village, let's fight and go for it.
It's motivational.
Yeah, and I'm like, yeah, I'm going to fight, debate now, you know? But that's a lot of showing off. I like your story more. So I want to thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you, it's been a pleasure.
You know, to just interview the writer I think is the best writer I know.
Thank
and
you
my
so
husband
much.
Is sitting over there, so he can say that I'm not lying. I've been nervous for 5 days. I'm glad it's over. And now I have a story to tell people. You know, I actually interviewed Jhumpa Lahiri. So thank you for that experience.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tanya Yatnanansingh and Jhumpa Lahiri, for being here and sharing your thoughts. Thank you very much, audience. There are books for sale in the back of this place. Paagman selling books. You can, if Jhumpa wants to sign, you can ask her for a signature. And we hope to see you all in January. There's the Writers Unlimited Festival from 16th to 19th of January here in The Hague. The website, you can have a look at the website for our program. And the next evening in the series is the 24th of January with Laurent Binet, who's being interviewed by Abdelkader Benali. Thank you very much. Hope to see you again.